is sign my name, publish and perish all the same.
So I will just describe a bit what we do on emissions, and I would like first to thank all my colleagues, so Katerina, Idir, who are here, by the way, Cathy, who is here, also here, Sabine here as well, who work in Toulouse, and my colleagues in the US, and also the colleagues in the Netherlands, and you will see that they do a lot of work on the regional emissions. So first, the system, the way it works, and I don't think you have seen this picture yet, but because it's quite well used a lot. So what we want to look at when we do modeling is different type of emissions. And we have the natural emissions, volcanoes, but a lot of emissions related to anthropogenic emissions, biogenic emissions. We have aerosol sources, so Cathy will talk about it later. And we also have oceanic sources and lightning and aircraft and so on. So what I will talk about in this talk is mostly anthropogenic emissions, and I will give more generalities and don't go too much into details of aerosols. And Cathy will talk about it. And there have already been working groups, and there will be a few more on that. I will talk rather briefly on, very briefly on biogenic emissions. And if you want to know a lot about that, so Katerina has a working group later. And I will mention very, very briefly other natural emissions. And you already know that, so Johannes did a very good presentation yesterday on biomass burning, and I won't talk at all about it. So what do we care about emissions? It's not only because of modeling. It's also because the only actions and decisions we can do to clean the atmosphere, improve climate, and so on, is to change emissions. We have no other ways to change anything on our planet. And so, but if we want to do to change emissions, we need to know how. And to know how to change emissions, we need accurate emissions to quantify and predict atmospheric composition, but also to understand changes in air quality and climate. And you saw from the talks the previous days that emissions have a very large importance in all that. But also to know the choices we have. Should we change cut trees, for example, to have less biogenic emissions? Should we change engines of the cars to have less emissions than that? But if we want to know what to do, we need to know the current emissions. And you will see that we are very far from that. And so the emissions are really the tools now for regulation, economics, foreign policy, and also international diplomacy. And I won't go into trading of emissions, but this is really a very important thing when people talk about regulating emissions. So the thing is that, as for all the works we are doing, we need really broadly accessible, very high quality emissions, but we have to maximize our very sparse resources, which in emissions is really, really small. So the challenges, what people want when they use emissions, they want them to be transparent, to know exactly which data you use. They want them to be consistent, because you don't want to have one species that going up in emissions and another one totally linked to the first one going down and stuff like that, so it has to be consistent. Obviously, you want it to be accurate. You want them to be in time, so you don't want now to have the emissions of 2000. You want the emissions of 2012 or 13. And you want to know the uncertainty. And I would say on all that, we are very far away from reaching any of these goals. And the reason why, and just broad reasons, is very complex. So like Johannes showed yesterday, all these emissions have a lot of spatial and temporal variation. And it's the same not only for fires, but all emissions. The types of sources are extremely different. You have cars, you have energy production, you have all types of industries, you have solvents, and you have also fires, you have the different trees, different vegetation, and so on. And the work has to be interdisciplinary, because if you look at emissions, for example, of anthropogenic emissions from traffic, you need to work with traffic regulation people, because they need to tell you how many cars are in each road, and so on. So you need to have a lot of interdisciplinary work. You need to spend a lot of time to work on inconsistencies. And it's what already Jean-Noël showed, for example, yesterday on observations, but it's the same for everything. As I said, you need to have them on time. And you want them to be traceable. So And I will show you that we use a lot of old data, and people have retired, or people didn't write documentation, and you don't know what it is. But it's and the only data you have sometimes. So I need to do detailed analysis. You want to evaluate all this data. I'll show quite a bit on that. You need to know the uncertainties. And I can already tell you that I won't talk about it because we have almost no idea about that. And I think Frederick will come to that because when you do like data simulation, as was shown yesterday, or inverse modeling, you want to know the uncertainty on the emissions. The problem, we don't know them. You want to know the impact of these emissions. And you want to communicate because when people use your data, they need to know all the documentation if you have it. They want to have literature access, knowing that on emissions, there are not so many papers, more and more papers, but a lot of what we call gray literature, which means it's reports. And when you click on the link, they have disappeared very often. So you need really to be careful on that. And you need to have links with the people who produce the data. So the problem also, depending on what you want to do, we need different characteristics for the data. For example, if you want to analyze or forecast the atmospheric composition or analyze data from campaigns, and Idir will talk about how we do that on the campaigns, but what you want to do, you want to have emissions for a large number of species, because generally when you do an aircraft campaign, for example, or even ground campaign, you have very a lot of instruments that measure a lot of species, a lot of different compounds. And so you need to have the information all of that. And you want, obviously, high spatial and topological resolution. As Hannah showed, if you have an aircraft campaign, it has very high spatial resolution, and you want the emissions at this scale. But if you do global scale or long range transport, you don't need that many chemical species because your model cannot afford it. Maybe 80 species or something like that, and among which maybe 15 or 20 are emitted at the ground. But you don't need that much spatial and topological resolution because your model generally cannot afford better than 0.5 degree at the global scale, and just a few models do that, generally 1 degree. But you want long-term variations. You want a few decades. Why not? And also, you need to couple your emissions with meteorological conditions. Because if you run your model for 30 years, a lot of things have changed. So you really need to look at that. And I'll talk just briefly about that also. And if you want to do climate studies, you have other, even more requirements. You want also the long-lived species that most of the time the other people don't need. You know, CO2, if you just look at a campaign, you don't really need CO2 emissions except when you want to do some analysis of your data. And you want aerosols, and you want generally a few other precursors. But you need to know exactly how your emissions have reacted to land use, because land use has changed a lot, because we talk about decay, emissions over decades or centuries. And you want also to know how all these emissions are linked to human activities. And you want to know past and future realistic scenarios. And this is not obvious, especially for the future, because as you know, economics, people working in economies always give scenarios, but you know, they are what they can. Guy talked a bit about it, and the problem is scenarios, they are just scenarios, that's it. You don't know what really the future will be. So, and also, a problem in all that, you need also to talk with other communities. So it's not only atmospheric research that needs emissions. So as we said, you need that for atmospheric modeling, but you also need it for health, to know how it will impact human health. But you know also how to deal with the data to look at permits of emissions, compliance and accountability. And Laurence Rouille will be here on Saturday. We'll talk about that. And she will go in much more details also in, she has a working group on air quality policies. No, this way. And so you need also the standard public reporting, emission trading, and all that. And also you need that for foreign policy. And I think Paul Monk mentioned this convention. So it's an international convention in the Northern Hemisphere about the long-range transport of pollution. And you have also very different international agreements. I won't go into that. And all the assessments like IPCC. So just a few words about the different approaches. I'll talk about bottom-up, so where you just no emission for different processes, for the time, for specific time, and they are not always speciated and so on. And Frederick will talk about top-down emissions, where you use observations to really infer emissions. But I will talk only on bottom-up emissions in this talk. And the bottom-up methodology is very similar to the one you have seen in Johannes talk yesterday, very similar. The formula is almost always the same. You have the emission is the sum of different different factors. One is the emission factor, which is the mass of compound emitted by the source by a unit of activity. And what is an activity? It's, for example, it's the amount of fuel burned, the vehicles, miles driven, and so on. It's really the activities that lead to the emissions. And then you have an emission factor, which is very often in gram per kilogram. And then you have also effectiveness of control measures. So if you put, if you take into account, for if you put suddenly catalytic converters in your car, so you need to know what the impact will be on emissions. So basically, this is this formula. And then you get that very often for just a country or a county in the US, for example, or a bit smaller administrative areas. And then you need to give a spatial allocation, temporal variability, and speciation, and so on. So I'll come back to that. And for example, this is the way ship emissions are defined. For example, it's exactly what I told you. You have the world fleet data, very, very difficult to get, by the way. And then you know you get the activity data depending on your type of ships and so on, what they carry and so on. Then you need you get the fuel consumption in each of the ships. Then you use emission factors, which are depending on the species. So you get all these emission factors, and then you get the total of the emissions. And it's by country, by generally here is by ocean, by sea, and so on. And then from that you get from somewhere the traffic densities in this case, so something which tells you where the ships are, and then you get a geographical distributed emissions, and then you can use that in your models. And for all the data, the emissions we do, it's like that, and Cathy already described that in a working group yesterday. A problem is that you have huge amount of uncertainties, and one of them is really the emission factors. For example, this is a paper that was published in 2004 by the Finnish group that shows in, in milligram per kilometer, the emission factor from cars, I think it's N2O emissions, for different conditions. So the scale goes from 0 to 140, and you see that basically you have all the values you want. And the problem is that when you do even a regional or global inventory, generally, you use one number per, not only per country, but per big, large regional areas. In this case, which one would be your average value? Nobody has any idea. So if you pick maybe here, but in many conditions, you are really overestimating the emissions. But and if you pick a lower value, you might underestimate the emissions. And this kind of uncertainty is the same for all emission factors. The problem is not quantified. And so this shows you already how we have so many uncertainties. So now I'll tell you how the current inventories that we use are developed, and I'll come back to that in the working groups this afternoon. So, but the way it's also done that what we want to do is to have emissions for the current time, most of the time. The problem is, and you will see that in some tables, that we have almost no inventories that go beyond 2000. We are 2013, so what do you do? And so you can use future projections. But the problem is what happened in the past, generally, it was two communities. So the past and current emissions are one community, basically kind of people like us. And you have the people from the future scenarios, and there are two very famous groups in Europe, one in it's called PBL now, or RIV? No, PBL now. In the Netherlands, and one in Yaza in Austria. You have one group in Japan and one in the US, basically. It's almost it. But we didn't talk to each other. So in the IPCC report released in 2007, basically, you had that. So you had the emissions dropping in 2000. And then you had the jump because the scenarios took another reference, and they didn't take all the same reference, by the way. And so when you did your run from the past to the future, you had a lot of the jump or the changes you had were just because emissions went from one value to another one. So in 2009, we decided to change a bit this system. So we are a group of maybe 20, 30 people. And we did what we call the handshake process. So we met and we started to know each other. That took kind of a long time because we don't work exactly the same way and so on. And we need to understand the way we work. And so it was done 2008, 2009. And finally, we decided that in this report that will be released this year, so you will hear a lot about it. I think the executive summary for policymakers will be released soon, and the real report at the end of the year. But the problem, the report will be released this year, but you have to do that 5 years in advance. And so we met with these guys, and we decided, we were in 2008, we had no emissions beyond that, so we decided that in 2000, everybody will agree on the emissions. So now you have a totally consistent data set, and you have several papers that is describing this process and so on. And so the way it worked basically is that, I won't go into details, I'll do that this afternoon, but we took existing inventories that, by the way, are totally inconsistent, and we tried to make them consistent for all species, all sectors, and so on. It took 2 years to do that. And this inventory, for example, now covers 1850 to 2000. It's available for each decade at no seasonal variation and 0.5 degree by 0.5 degree resolution. And a bit later, so about, I think we did that 2010, we realized that providing emissions by decade might be okay for people doing climate models, but for us it's not really useful. So we decided, and also we wanted to have emissions beyond 2000, so we are using one of the future scenarios. And we did some linear interpolations, and now we have an inventory that goes from 1980, we started in 1980 for this one, to 2013 for every year. And we implemented very crude seasonal emissions, seasonal variation of the emissions. So basically is the way it works. And I don't know, I think we had somebody, maybe it was Jean-Noël, who showed something like, you know, a soup and so on. It's a bit like cooking, you know, you say, oh, it's not enough salt, not enough pepper. It's a bit like that. So, oh, put it a bit higher so that it's more consistent. It's the way it was done, but I should say currently it's only inventory that covers this period. So now what we want to do is try to see how good are all these inventories. How to do that? So we spend quite a lot of time just to gather all what I call public inventory. And this is important because some people who I say, oh, my data were not involved in your analysis. I say, OK, give us the data. I say, no, no, we will give all you the numbers for the period you want. And we say, no, we want public data set because if somebody wants to do it, you can. And so in the paper that was published 2011, we were 26 authors from I don't know how many countries. Frederick was on board, for example. And so we try to gather several inventories. So we have global inventories giving access to all species. You see, you don't have too many. Some of them are giving only one species, like, for example, the inventory developed by Cathy on black carbon and so on. Some other inventories only SO2. And we have a few more since, because it was 2 years ago, and there are a few more that. This one, by the way, will be on the ACAT database, hopefully in 2 weeks or so. Another one is being developed that will be a global for a few years, very high resolution. And we have put on this paper all the links. By the way, some of them are not working anymore. So it's also the problem that the links are changing all the time, but there is nothing we can do on that. And we did the same for regional inventories, because when we want to compare data, we should not only look at global data set, but also we want some regional one. For example, you could see this one is the one used in the MAC report and so on. And I should say, since there are a lot of progress, so there is a new TNO MAC inventory going up to 2009. You see it's a regional inventory, but it still goes only to 2009 because we don't have the data to go to 2013. We have three new inventories that I think this one, the REAS inventory, is in an ACP discussion, I think, and the other one might have been published since. There is the inventory developed by Eric Michel and Cathy for Africa. We have some new inventories for Canada. And there might be also some more, so, but we don't know about them. So I'll tell you later how you can, if you know about inventories or you develop some, how you can reach us. The question now is, are any of these inventories accurate? So the problem is that if I use one data set, so this list in my model or in my analysis of observations, will I get better results if I use another inventory? Maybe, but how do I know that? And so I should say within Gaia, and I will come back to that, we have started some kind of systematic evaluations of surface emissions. And we have started with the 1980 to 2010 period because it's when we have the most number of emissions. And as I said, we only consider publicly available inventories because we want other people to be able to reproduce that or update that in the future. And we have started to focus CO, NOx, SO2, and black carbon. And but I should not say recently because it was done 6 months ago, but we are now working on papers on methane, organic carbon, total VOCs, and ammonia. And just to show you how it looks like, and for example, this is CO, so the top is total emissions, US emissions, and Western Europe emissions. And you start to see that even at the global scale, you know, should agree, but it's not that good. And only thing you can say that all the most data sets agree on the sign of change. So it's a good sign, but you know, when you want emissions, you want better than that. But you still have a lot of differences in the amount emitted. So at this point, you say, oh, but yeah, but maybe the regional inventories would give much better data. By the way, they're on here, but you don't see them very well. And so this is a study done by my colleagues at NOAA. And what they did, they took the EPA inventory, so the official US inventory. I should use my mouse, but too late. Anyway. And this is, for example, the emissions, official emissions reported in the US for CO, and they're here in orange. But you see that all the global inventories are much lower. So most of people would say, oh, yeah, so it shows that global data set, you don't know enough and so on, they might be wrong. But what they did, is that they did a lot of campaigns just going across the US, like that, and so on, with a lot of data. And they did, they inferred the emission, not a fully inverse modeling system, but all close. And what they inferred is this, which is very close to the global inventories. So which shows that it's not because you have regional data sets that are reported by countries that they're better than global inventories that are defined by this formula I showed you. So at the present time, you know, we don't really know what are the best data sets. So what generally we do a run with one data set, a run with another one, and we see if there is a large difference and give you some uncertainties. And so Frédéric will talk about inverse modeling, which might be a good way to improve our knowledge, but it's still limited to a few species. There are lots of species for which we have almost no measurements. And so it means that we still need really long-term monitoring and specific campaigns if we want to improve on our knowledge of emissions. So, and just observations of concentration is extremely useful for a lot of different topics. And this is, for example, on the top CO emissions in India and China, and NOx emissions in India and China as well. And I should say the newest emissions, so this is the REAS2, the paper just published for India, for example. And you see that basically, if you have too much CO emissions in your model, you take an inventory, you will decrease it by factor of 2, basically. So there is no way of knowing which data set is the best. The red one is this MaxCity I showed you about. But for now, there is still a very large uncertainty, more than factor of 2 among all these data sets. And if you look at black carbon, for example, it's not really better. This is ammonia. This is SO2. And sometimes in ammonia, for example, this is typical data set for which you say, oh, maybe the agreement is a bit better than other data. Just, it looks a bit better because we have almost no data, so everybody is using the same. So you have also to be careful about the way you interpret the differences between data sets. And this is another thing showing also that when you have differences, when you have new reprocessed data set at the regional scale, for example, this is ammonia in the US, these are the data released in 2008, data released in 2012, and you see quite a bit of difference. So the agencies, they reprocess their data all the time. And you have also, you need to have quite a bit of the history of all this data if you want to understand all of it. And this is total VOCs, for example, where you see it's relatively good agreement that all the emissions are decreasing, but it's close to a factor of 2 to 3 in some locations, the differences. So what we did in this paper, we could not define uncertainties because none of these data sets come with uncertainties. So we decided, OK, let's do the ratio between the highest and the lowest emissions for black carbon, CO, NOx, and SO2. So in green, it means the ratio between the lowest and highest values is between 1 and 125. Yellow is 1.25 to 1.5. Orange up to 175. And gray above 1.75. So what you see is that among NOx, most of the data sets for 1980, 1990, 2000, 2005, they almost all agree. So NOx is the species where we think we have the best definition of the emissions. You see already in black carbon, there is not even one green location. Same for CO, except the last one for China. And SO2 is the same. But again, it's not because you have a good consensus yet that you have accuracy. And also, I should say that, and I think Frederick could talk about that, none of these data, the one I showed you, are independent. Because you will see that some of you are already postdocs and so on. You work in one location. You go to another location. You bring all your data with you. And by the way, more and more, this data are absolutely not independent. So then we thought, OK, let's, since we don't know exactly why all these data are different, let's look at more details. Let's look at sectors. But the problem is that life is not really simple in the emission world. So in that, there is no consensus at all on the definition of sectors. On the global scale, most people use what we call IPCC or UNFCCC sectors, and I say most. And on the regional scale, there are absolutely no agreements. The Europeans use subsectors. EPA in the US use another definition. All countries basically have their own definitions, and they don't match. It would be too simple. And for example, if you look at traffic, we think that, you know, land transport and road transport should be almost the same. Already, you want to look at ships. You don't have much luck because in IPC sector, there are marine transport. But in the SNAP sector, is other transport, which is not road transport. And how do you match? You know, in one case, it's only ships. The other case, it could be a lot of things like all traffic in harbors, which is huge. It goes into the non-road. So when you want to compare ships emission, for example, you don't know what to do. And if you want to compare energy production, it's not absolutely defined totally different way. So anyway, only stuff that seems to be almost the same is solvents. But I mean, it's only for a few VOCs for which you have large emissions. But for most of the sectors, you can't. So what we try to do up to now only is to assume that what we call land transport is the same as road transport. And this is what we did up to now. So this is the US CO and NOx in the US, Western EU, and China. And you see that, for example, in NOx, even I showed you that it's the species for which we have apparently the best consensus on the data set. But if you go by sectors, it's one of the species for which you have the less consensus. So, and you see that they absolutely don't match nowhere. And even in China, it's kind of interesting. And if you look at CO, by the way, in China, it's also interesting that it's totally different. So it shows you. So we are working more and more on that. So trying to ask people producing emission data set to go to subsectors, not only sectors, but subsectors, and trying to do some work. And I should say the group in GRC, in Italy, Great Manout, and Frank Dentner, and so on, they are really trying to do some work on that within this Edgar H. Tap. They will try to provide subsectors data and so on, and maybe we'll get that from other people. Try to understand really where the main uncertainties are coming from. So I'll talk to you about a few ideas, also other issues that we have. And there's many, many, but I'll talk only about a few of them. Short-term variations, because all this data, when you get the data, you would like to have them with daily variation or weekly variation. But you don't, generally. Like the regional data set, like provided by EMEP, so the European body doing emissions in Europe, they're only yearly averages. EPA in the US is the same, and so on. they are all only yearly averages. What about the grading? Because all these emissions are done generally by country, and then I showed you in the process you have to grid them. Issue about ship emissions, and Paul already mentioned a bit, VOC speciation, update of emission, and also impact of the new resources extraction, and Cathy will talk about aerosol, so I won't talk about that. So this is almost, in the next two slides, you will see most of the information we know on seasonal variation and temporal variation. So this is, for example, for all species. It's from RIVM, the Netherlands, so some kind of old data. And where you have some factors, so around one, for different sectors. And here you have the same kind of thing for hourly variation, also from different sectors. But we don't have details on difference between countries, between species. We would apply that to all species. And this is a bit updated, but still quite old data. And it gives you by season for VOC, by sector, and external variation and CO weekly emissions. And basically, it's only what we have. And so we define some factors based on that. And the way we implement it in the emission data set is very easy. So we just have function season. When we are south of the equator, we apply exactly the opposite, and that's it. So it's very, very basic. But now people start to use satellite data. So this is a use of NO2 emission, NO2 data that John talked about yesterday, where so my colleagues at NOAA, so Siwan Kim and so on, they use the satellite data to find out for each day of the week, depending on cities, the variation of the emission of NO2. And what we can see, for example, in these big cities like Los Angeles, San Francisco, and so on, you have a huge variation in emissions, because it's big cities where you don't have that much transportation and so on, and you have huge amount of differences. If you go to Kansas, or so on, where you know traffic is relatively small in some cities and so on, and it's almost constant during the week. So based on these kind of studies, we can find out, apply some proxies to some cities, the way people work, to try to implement days of the week variation and so on. But this will be a long process, but it's one of the ways to do it. Another problem is the grading. So the grading is also an issue, and this is some slide I took from the Umwelt Bundesamt in Austria, I think. The way it's done, so basically you have different proxies to grid your data. So you have data for a country, so you can use population, it's okay, but to scale traffic emission to population might not be the right thing to do, because you would miss all the freeways. You have also sectoral data reported by different countries. You have some gridded data by some countries. And you have also large point sources, because most of the countries, they know where the big factories are. So they give all this information. And then, for example, for some roads, you can talk with the road management people, and they would tell you that this road, you know, traffic is very dense, and so on and so on. And based on that, this is for the Netherlands, you can come to quite detailed data set, gridded data set. And the way it's done, for example, so, and these are all these snap sectors I told you about. I won't go into detail. For example, sector 7, which is road transport, is defined between, you know, gridded sectoral data. So they have data on roads. Agriculture, which is sector 10, they have some data about where you have most of the places where you raise pigs and so on and so on. And you have sometimes you have large point sources. So some sectors you'd say, oh, we will use 50% population data to grid that and 50% of large point sources. But it shows you that even we provide very high resolution gridded data, it's not, they don't come like that. So it's a process that is applied to the emissions. This is, for example, the NOx emissions from the TNO-MAC data set, where you see large, really a lot of details on the data sets. And I'll talk more about it but later this afternoon. But it shows you that you have to be careful. When you look at, for example, observations, it's not because you have a high emission there that it's really there. It could be a bit different in spatial location. So, another problem is also the regular updates of emissions. Because what you would think, you know, we have data up to 2010, 2000, for example, and I told you oh, we are still using 2000 and then we use future scenarios. And you could say, oh, why not use updated emissions? So this is what the TNO group did within MAC. So the data in red are the ones that were used for the first TNO MAC data sets that some of you use in their models. And Virginie will talk, no, Vincent Rie first and Virginie later will talk about all these regional models. And then they thought, you know, they said, oh, let's take the most recent data in blue and just update the emissions with the new years. But if you look at that, for example, let's look at, for example, in Denmark, here is 2007 from EMEP, so the European body. But in between, they had not only provided an update of the emission, but they reprocessed the full data set. And they changed also the 2007 data set. So 2007 in the previous inventory was here, now it's here. So it's about 10-15% difference. So which means that also when you do regular updates, it's not obvious. You have to update generally a full data set. So it's again that the consistency is quite not easy to match. And a user, this is from Hugo from TNO, who said, what a user from another discipline will not understand. So it's when you provide data to people who said, OK, we will give you the 2003 to 2000 data set. And then we provide now 2005 to 2009. But the 2005 has changed because it has been reprocessed. So you have to be very careful also when you use that. Read the documentation when it's available. So another topic that has also large uncertainties, so this is ships, already mentioned a bit by Paul, I think, yeah, or Guy or John, I forgot. But why do we care really about ship emissions? And I show here a slide for Europe, but it's the same for all countries, is that now that for air quality purposes, what has been regulated a lot is NOx emissions with a catalytic converters and so on. So the land emissions, which are here in yellow, for 2000 here, they will be decreased more and more. So now it's a 2020 here in yellow emissions for SO2 and NOx. But at the same time, what about the ships? So ships are burning the dirtiest fuel you can imagine because nobody wants it, and the ship's engine can use it. So they use extremely dirty fuel, and very often in harbors, you will hear the noise of the engine is because the fuel is so dirty that if they stop the engine, it won't start again, basically. But they use it. It's not regulated. Maybe in 2015, they might have some regulations. And normally, the European harbors will prevent ships who don't have two engines to enter. So a dirty engine for the seas and a clean engine, rather clean engine for the harbors. So these are the ideas. But for now, the regulation is not mandatory. And also, as you might know, most of the ships are not registered in countries that are putting this regulation in force. So this is we don't know exactly who will really implement the regulations. But the problem is that what will happen is that SO2 and NOx emissions will increase. And we think by 2020, the emissions of NOx from sea and land in Europe will be exactly the same. So which means that if in your models you don't take into account in the next few years ships, you will miss a lot of the NOx emissions. And if you miss NOx, as Paul showed, you miss most of the ozone and so on. So it's very important now to know to take care of the ships. Problem is, do we know the ships? So this is, for example, the inventory on ship emissions from the global data set, so here. And this has done was done mostly by DLR in Germany and Manchester University in the UK. And you see something that looks reasonable. Then on top of that, we have put the emissions recommended by EMEP, so European body. The reason they stop here because it's their the area they cover. But already you see that according to EMEP, one of the big routes for going from Europe to US or Canada is this one. According to the other data set, it's not there. It's here. There is only 10 degree or 15 degree latitude difference, which is huge. So where are the ships? We don't really know. It's a problem. So, and first we said, by the way, we will harmonize all the ships' data and do a very good data set, but we realize it's almost impossible. So now we are working with, we try to work with people who have the data on ship routes to improve all that. The problem is that these data are awfully expensive. They are not public at all. they belong to the ship companies and they won't give you the data, especially for looking at pollution. They don't want to do that. So ships will change. I mean, the research on ships will move forward, but now it's still very difficult to know better. The good thing is that we start to have very good observation from space. So this is NO2 from OMI, so this the group from KNMI. And where you see, so this is a map of a tropospheric column of NO2, where you start to see somewhere some ships' routes and so on. And where can we use that to improve the data set? Not really here, because you have a lot of NO2, but is it coming from ships? Is it coming from cars transported across the channel and so on? And but here in this area, it's obvious that it's only ships, and here as well. So what was done by the group in the Netherlands is that they looked at the EMEP data set, so specifically for Mediterranean Sea, the OMI data here at high resolution. This is one of the data sets that is providing ship data. And this is what they infer from that. So what you can see here is that the route proposed by EMEP is much too close to Greece. And so what they think that using, and not only the thing, but what they do is using the satellite data, we are able to correct the location of some of the ship's location, ship emissions. We are still far away from doing that on the amount of emissions, because the satellite measure really a column, which is not always sensitive to what happens on the ground. But this shows you that we have ways of improving stuff for the future. And by the way, what we are also looking at for the future is that the patterns will change for many reasons, especially in the Arctic. Now already you start to have a lot of ships going from either from China, Japan to Europe using the northern sea route. And we start also to have ships going to the northwest sea route, because now most of these areas in the summer there is no ice. Starting 2-3 years ago, now you can take a cruise ship and you can go from Alaska to Montreal or something like that on a cruise ship. So, and it's common, it's totally common, and it will be more and more common. And now the companies want really to use these routes. So which means that the patterns will change. And by the way, we are working on a European project on defining all these ship routes with a group in Norway. And we have also maybe some other ship routes that will also appear. So we really have to work on all that. So more briefly now, VOC speciation, some work that we are doing with my colleague Ariela, who is both in Paris and in Argentina, Erika, who is in Berlin, and Paul Monks as well, where we try to look at the speciation of VOCs. So currently, many inventories use a speciation that was developed by TNO for retro project, but it's rather old data, and we could not really find the documentation, by the way. And so we try to have new methodology under development using speciated observations. And this is, for example, here in red, the ratio between CO emissions to each VOC here. I won't give you all the details, but different individual VOCs to CO. And this is a log scale, so huge differences. And this is observations. Even if observations are not supposed to match exactly the emissions, you should not have a factor of 100 of 1,000 difference. So what we are trying to do is use the CO emission inventory, the ratios provided by the observation, and define some new VOC inventories. And the first test seem to provide good results, but for some regions like Africa and South America, we have almost no information. So, but we try to do that. So another thing also that was mentioned by Paul, so it's why I mentioned it also, this is the fracking and new emissions of methane and VOCs. So this is a picture of Wyoming, where before you had only cowboys and so on and cows. Now you just have holes everywhere. You have wells everywhere, almost. And you have, by the way, 120 ppb of ozone every all January and February in this location where nobody lives, which is way, way above the health standards. And one of the reasons is because of that. So some colleagues took a car. They just went all the small roads and so on. This is methane. And the normal methane is something like 1.9 or 1.8, 1.9 ppm. But in this area, you go to 3 ppm of methane. So in a remote area where nobody lives, it's really strange, and ozone is huge. And so I will pass this one. So what happened is that, so all this data, this campaign was last year or so. No, this winter as the previous winter. And this is what this EPA inventory had for gas leaks or gas extraction in their inventory, very low values. Now they agreed that now with all this extraction, the pattern has changed, and they have totally changed their inventory. So also this means that we need to be really reactive, but I should say also the people doing the extraction, they don't like really to have cars or airplanes fly going around their wells. So it's kind of an interesting game. And but it shows also, you know, the, that we need really to take into account all that. So uncertainties, I just discussed just a bit. So we have many. So error in the emission factor, I told you a bit about it. The countries that report emissions also is not always uniform, almost not really transparent, and so on. And in Europe, you know, it's also the problem that you have different countries, so some countries report very strange values, but nobody wants to say, oh, you are the bad guy, and so on. And no other agency is really looking at it. So it's kind of not easy. VOC speciation, I told you about, is not a problem. And so, by the way, I think Cathy will talk about it. We also know some missing emissions, like I told you about the fracking, but resuspension of particles is another one, and so on. So now, just a few words about biogenic emissions. And so if you think that you could go breathe the good air from trees and so on to be into very fresh air with no hydrocarbons and so on, might not be good, might be better than that, but not. So Caterina will tell you much more about all that, all these emissions released by the vegetation. But just some ideas how it works. So most of us now use a model similar to what is called MEGAN, so developed at NCAR by Alex Günther with colleagues from many other countries that are visiting him all the time. And basically, you use the source density from leaf area index maps, so amount of vegetation. You need to know the weather, you need to know CO2 concentration, and you need to know the source types. And what Alex is doing in his lab is measuring a lot of the emission factors and so on, and then you get to resolved emission estimates. And for example, this is just a plot showing that the impact of temperature on the isoprene emissions. So it's why you really need to know really all these details about the different factors. So Caterina will cover all that. And this is, for example, a plot that Caterina just finished, and this data set is online now in ECAD. And you see that over the last 30 years, the way emissions have changed, so this is a function of latitude and so on. So you see that you have a lot of change and that you need to take into account in your data set. So just a few words about the other natural emissions. So we have oceans emissions. Oceans emit DMS, dimethyl sulfoxide, that will be covered maybe not, I don't know, in Cathy's talk on aerosols. But they also emit alkenes, for example, and so on. But the newest data set we know is from 92. From Jean-François Muller in Belgium, and we don't have any seasonal variation, no yearly, year-to-year variation. Everybody is using the same data. In volcanoes, we just have one graded data emission that is quite old, but there is a paper now in discussion, ACPD, that is providing data sets that are not graded, but hopefully they will be graded soon. For soils, most models now have an interactive scheme where soils is related to fertilizer, when you apply fertilizers and so on. And you have release of different nitrogen compounds. But again, we have some data, yearly average data that we can provide, but they're not really good. And lightning, I won't talk about it, but most models now, they have their own line scheme, which is based on flash frequency, NOx production rate per flash, and so on. Just a few minutes to tell you where to get the data. We already had one working group on the ECAD database. You have, by the way, a sticker on the tables. And just to show you just a website. And Sabine this afternoon will talk again about it, so if you want to know more. So this is the homepage. And these are the list of inventories. We have a lot of global inventories, regional inventories, a lot of compounds. And many different tools to to plot, to process, to calculate totals, to evaluate all that. And I should say now, a lot of people using ACAD, so 940 users this morning or something like that, for 400 institutes, and the color shows the number of people in each institute using this data. So you see people from most of the countries. And then all this is part of GAIA, so Paul talked already about AGAC, and GAIA is a sub-project of AGAC that is dealing with how to get to data concerning emissions, and the idea is to look at how to improve the access to the data, how to analyze, how to build a community around emissions. And idea is really to define projects for analyzing the data, evaluation, and new emissions. Community, so we really want to develop a community around emissions, and also the access, so through ACAD database, and we have other projects doing that. And if you are really interested in emissions, you are all invited in Boulder in June next year for a conference on bridging emission science and policy. And I still have a few minutes, so I will just tell you just a bit of something which is under development that might take 4 or 5 years, maybe, to develop, maybe more, maybe less. It's interoperability, so this is a fancy word that politicians like it. If you put that in a proposal, you have good chances. And so the way it's done is that we have some data, MAC data, HDAP, and so on, in one of the servers in Jülich, in Germany, and you have other servers in other countries. And the idea is to be able to do a plot, for example, of a model results that is somewhere, and an emission data set, for example, that is somewhere else, and where you would, where you don't have to download the data, but you can use all these tools, interoperable tools, to plot all that without having to download the data. There are a lot of technical issues involved, and we have to make it user-friendly, because I know only one guy who knows how to, maybe two or three, we know how to make really this plot, because it's working, but it's totally non-user friendly. So, but it should work in a few years, because there are a lot of stuff about, we don't want hackers also to destroy the stuff, because it's always outside the firewalls to be able to work. So we have a lot of issues. So finally, I want to talk about that. So what we need high quality emission information to understand the atmosphere. We need bottom-up inventories, but there are a lot of challenges with that. So there are still very significant disagreements between global and regional data sets. But we need to identify the cause of the difference, and we need to quantify uncertainties. But it's difficult because we don't have the information. And we really need to use better information observations. So our Frédéric will talk about that. And if you are really interested in participating in all this activity, I invite you to go to the GAIA website and register, and you will be part of that. And just the stuff where we are now, so infrequent temporal availability, species and region-dependent inventories, and so on, state, and all these data sets that are different. That are different scales which are not compatible. And what we really want to know is to have emission trends at different dates with different methods and so on, documented data, user-friendly access and so on, and graded inventories with all sectors and so on. So this is really where we want to go. And so thank you for your attention. So, yeah. So while Frédéric is coming, I just want to say just a few words today that, as I said, the group called Emission Database